be on that Philly. I be on that Philly shoe. I be on that Philly. I be on that Philly shoe. I be on that Philly. I be on that Philly shoe. The South Philly, the Northwest yeah. Philly shoe.
215, North Philly reside. Louis print on my lens, 5% on my ride. King of pressure, keep me fresh. I got my polos on. Let my car go slay without the logos on. Hey, no red fitted white P, that's me. It's the act Nicholas One, Young EST. Gangster like Schoolie T, no fraud in here. It's the fresh press of the city, no cotton in here.
My name is Ivben Taqiy. I'm 29 years old. I'm a Philadelphia native. I've been painting for about 22 years. And, you know, basically, I look at myself as a hip-hop, you know, artist slash, you know, I do graffiti, I do realism, I do abstract, you know, I basically do whatever I feel in the flow of art, you know. And, you know, a lot of people have heard about me, they've checked out my work, and, you know, I bring to you, you know, live and direct, and just make sure that, you know, it's nice and funky and creative. People love creative stuff, and people love to see talented people win, so let's you know, watch my life. Growing up, you know, I was raised in a household with five other siblings, which were all girls. And, you know, watching them and playing with my sisters, you know, they wanted to do things like tea parties and going outside and playing jack. So I didn't really have that brotherhood where, like, my older brothers would play football with me or basketball and stuff. So I noticed that I had a pretty good creative side of me. You know, I was funny, had cool jokes and stuff. But my biggest thing that I was really good at, I was good at coloring. My mom would buy us coloring books. And, you know, as a kid, you would try to see who could stay inside the lines, who could mix the colors up and do stuff like that. And, you know, over the years, you know, going from age 3 to 5 to 7, you know, I've gotten better and better and better because I didn't want to play tea party or nothing like that. So I just, you know, took my skills to the next level on art and then started drawing and started doing cartoon characters. And, you know, I wrote my first book at age 7. A lady came to my mom and said, hey, look, your son's really good at drawing. I want to do a kid's coloring book, but I want it from a child's perspective. So doing that, and I made $300 off the gig. I was like, wow, $300 at age 7 is a lot of money. You know, it's just kind of cool that I can make money doing this. And then, you know, just being noticed more and more in high school or, you know, middle school and even elementary school from my peers and teachers that I say, you know what, I think I have a gift. And then for others, adults, teachers to notice that you have this gift, you know, you're saying to yourself, like, you know what, let me just see where this takes me, you know, and it's landed me here, you know, 20 something years later, doing amazing shows and just, you know, doing creative things. So my mom was never the type of person to buy us like cool stuff like sneakers or none of that stuff. So we went to the neighborhood Value City and neighborhood Payless. And I'm like, mom, I can't wear this shit to school, like straight up. Like the kids at school gonna laugh at me and stuff. You gotta buy me some name brand stuff. She's like, look, you got four siblings. You know, I can't afford name brand sneakers like Nike and all that stuff. So I'm like, all right, well, I gotta find a way to make some money. So, you know, I did the regular stuff as far as shoveling people's pavements and stuff like that. But when I noticed that people said, can you draw this and draw that? I would charge them a little $5 here and $6, $10 at the most. And I was like, you know what? I can do this. It doesn't cost me anything to do it. And it's not, and it's fun. I can make money at doing this. So then those $10 graduated from me doing, you know, portraits of people's families for $50 and $100. And I'm looking at myself like, all right, now I can buy those cool sneakers. My friends won't make fun of me no more. And I did all through my free hands and my free eye of doing art. So just being able to take care of myself and pay my bills and have fun with art, I say, you know what, let's make a career out of this, you know. I say I have more than one style. I've always been a kid that, just viewing other artists, I saw that, I don't know, how can I put this? There's so many different types of artists out there. You got your Rembrandt, you got your, I mean, let's say some of the ones that everybody know, Picasso in the Cubism style. You got your Basquiat and then the childish, you know, more fun and freestyle type of artwork. Then you got your tightly, you know, rendered drawings and paintings that look like real life stuff, you know. And I said to myself, like, before I can get my own style, I want to know if I can master all these other styles. And I've honestly mastered all these other styles to the point where I got my own styles where I can take a cumulative amount of all that stuff that I've seen growing up and say, at this point in time in this painting, I want to do this part or this style. So all my pieces have their own flow with them. You know, sometimes you'll see a tightly rendered piece, or sometimes you'll see, you know, loose and fun and just a more blocky or cubism type style or a more abstract type of style. So my piece is just like any kind of thing. You know, if you get a soup and the soup tastes delicious, you're going to have some parts of that soup that's going to be sweet, some parts of that soup that's going to be salty, some parts of that soup that's going to have a sultry, meaty taste to it, or a nice vegetable hearty taste to it. So I wanted to make my paintings have that soup feeling, that of all these different types of style mixed into one that gives you its own unique and creative look to it. So that's what I would say. I'm a combination of many styles that's just flowing off of my feeling, the motion of the piece, and the theme of what I'm working on mixed into one. So that way you can't ever copy or try to vindicate or try to make, you know, the same thing, because there's no recipe for how it was done. Well, this show right here is the Ali Art Show, and the reason why I did it, this is my third installation of my mic project. My mic project was I wanted to do three mics: Michael Jordan, Michael Jackson, and Mike Tyson. The first two shows were, of course, the Michael Jackson show, the first show was the Michael Jordan show. Now it's called Art Jam. That show was phenomenal, had a great turnout. Everybody loves Jordans. Jordan is the number one basketball player. I don't care if you're a fucking LeBron fan, a Kobe fan. Them niggas ain't got nothing on Michael Jordan, and we all know that. You know what I'm saying? He took some losses, took some wins. He got old, still played the game. He dresses corny as shit now, but at the end of the day, we all still Michael Jordan fans when it comes to basketball. The Bulls, 96, 93, 91 was the best fucking team ever, hands down. And we did the shit, we did the damn thing in the Olympics too. So we all know Michael Jordan was the man in basketball. You say basketball, you have to say Michael Jordan's name. You don't have to say Kobe. You don't have to say LeBron. You don't have to say none of those other niggas. You will have to say Jordan. So that's why I did Jordan for that show. The second thing was Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson is the number one entertainer of our time. The past five decades, that's every decade is 10 years. So if you can beat a man for 10 decades or five decades straight from 1960, when Michael Jordan was born, 1950, what, eight? So he'd been rocking out since 1967, 60, 63, maybe something like that, and having hits and working hard from 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, 2010, Michael still dropped the album and shit still went fucking platinum. Like, I don't know no other artist that's amounted to that kind of accomplishments as a human being, as an artist, as an entrepreneur, as a humanitarian for what Michael Jackson's done. So he's the number one entertainer of all time to this date. Anybody want to battle me on that shit? Meet me live, meet me in person, and we can have a full discussion. You're going to lose. So after that, I said, all right, cool. The Michael Jackson show was phenomenal. It was great. I had a great turnout. People loved it. Entertainers, you know, I had popcorn. I had a whole fucking, like, scene of, like, a museum or just, a, you know, whatever. So my third installation was the third mic, which was Mike Tyson. I had a debate with a couple friends of mine. I was like, yo, dog, I mean, Mike Tyson's cool and all. You know, he killed the game and shit like that. But, like, he's not the man in boxing. He's cool, but he's not the man. If you want to do somebody, and I feel like if you want to say the person who's the man in boxing, you got to go with Muhammad Ali. And the thing about it is choosing Muhammad Ali, it's like he's still alive, and I still wanted him to be able to smell the flowers while he's still alive and appreciate that. And I appreciate his essence. Who knows, man, got 5 years left, 10 years left. Who knows? I don't want to put a time frame on it. But Muhammad Ali, for what he did as for the culture of not just black people, for Muslims, or for young black men, or anything like that, he gave us something to look forward to and to work for. That's not taken away from Mayweather. That's not taken away from any other boxer you can name right now. But, you know, for me, Muhammad Ali set that precedence for me to say that was my hero. That was somebody I look up to, because he did something more than just the boxing. He really jumped into the economics of the world. You know, he fought overseas. He actually had a debate and a fight with United States over, you know, being drafted. These were all real things. He changed his name and defied what was accepted into regular society over these past years and stuff. He went to Olympics and did things, you know. And like I said, Mayweather's doing his thing right now, but, like, I don't get that from Mayweather. When I see Mayweather, I see the fucking Bugatti, I see white cars, I see bad bitches, I see all this other stuff. I don't see you saying, I'm giving back, I'm teaching these kids, blah, blah, blah. You know, I don't get that. So, I mean, you're not a fucking hero to me. You just a nigga that just learned how to get some money and get a check and take care of your damn self and your family. Cool. But at the end of the day, Muhammad Ali, he made checks and got money and all stuff too. But like for me as a young man growing up, he came from more hero aspect. He's a nigga that could fight Superman and possibly could win. You know what I'm saying? You're not gonna see a picture of Mayweather fighting Superman. So for me, these shows and the people that I do pick as my celebrities to do these shows and capture these the different paintings and stuff from, you know, it's more thought into it than what you think. And if you notice, I did this show, the Muhammad Ali show, around the time where everybody's talking about boxing because Mayweather has this huge fight that's coming up the week after this show. So there's a lot of thought that goes into when I'm doing these shows, who I choose, why I choose them, you know, and then, you know, just the essence of what the world is going around or society or, you know, everybody's in your inner circle is going around right now. So that's why the Muhammad Ali show is going to happen a week before Mayweather show, just because that's what's going on and what everybody's talking about and a popular thing right now, you know. My next show, which I'll explain at the show, but I'll give you guys a sneak peek. It's called Woman in the Water. And the reason why I'm doing this show called Woman in the Water is going to be my very first show that, you know, I had this celebrity, you know, clientele and people know me for that's not actually going to be centered around a celebrity. It's going to be centered around the powers of and the beauty of women and how a water can affect that. So I'm going to take the theme of water and take the theme of beautiful women and just the powers and, the, you know, the spirituality of water and women and mix that together. 90 to 80% of my fans are women, so I feel like they can respect that more to be able to see that, and they can, you know, they'll appreciate it, and you know, I can get even bigger and a larger group of people to see my work if I attain to those fans and give them what they want as far as me being able to step outside my comfort zone of doing these celebrities and, you know, growing as an artist myself. So Woman in the Water is gonna be an awesome show. I'm gonna probably get a banging ass sponsorship from a water company. You know, hopefully Diddy can sponsor this with one of his water company, or maybe 50, whoever one of these niggas got money that can help me with the sponsorship shit, because this shit ain't cheap. It cost me money for the paintings, cost me money for the paint, cost me money for venues, and like, honestly, I pay for it myself as an investment to myself, but you know, sometimes shit get a little bit more expensive than what you expect it to. So next show is Women in the Water. Y'all got an exclusive preview of what that's going to be about. It's going to be dope. I mean, just with that theme alone, you can see where it could elevate to and how creative I can get with that, you know? So the Philly art scene, Philly in general, is a very combative and doggy dog kind of like industry. You know what I'm saying? Anybody in Philadelphia that's doing something that's working for them, they get making money at it, you know, other cats, other females, males, whoever you are, you're going to see and say, wow, that worked for them. Maybe that can work for me. And the way Philly work is you're just going to always see that. You know what I mean? So the best thing about that is Philly is a great capital. There's so many talented and artistic and creative people here in the city. I think it's an overload of talented and creative people here in the city. The best thing to do if you are a Philly artist or any kind of entrepreneur or something like that, do what you got to do. Grind hard. Get the support. Give back to people that support you and people that love your craft. Give back to them some type of way by even coming to their events, showing love to them, buying their products. You know what I'm saying? Even by posting their information on your Instagram or sharing information. All those kind of things help and keep a strong and healthy relationship between you and other artists as an artist. So, you know, definitely the Philly scene is a great and wonderful place. But honestly, when you make it here in Philadelphia, get what you got, get out this motherfucker, get your support, then get the fuck out of here and go to other cities and let them niggas see you too. Because any nigga from Philly that do their thing here, if you can do it here and make it here and be seen, be heard, and get your fucking money, go to another city and you're gonna make twice as much, quadruple as much, or whatever, and you're gonna get huge. Philly don't respect you as a nigga if you stay in here. They respect you when you go the fuck out of here and make it. Then they'll say, oh yeah, I remember that motherfucker. He was doing his damn thing. I'm gonna buy his shit. You know what I'm saying? So that's just how Philly work. You know what I mean? No disrespect. I love my city. Y'all niggas help me down forever. But on some real shit, when it's time for me to roll up out this bitch, y'all gonna love me when I'm gone. So that's just straight up. Yeah, because niggas want to put money in their own pockets. Nobody really is really caring about the arts. I mean, I've seen that from my own point of view. Like, nobody gives a shit about your art, for real, for us. Talking about the people that's the politicians or the people behind the desks and stuff. They don't really care about the arts. They want to know how much money's coming into their budgets, and then they want to say, okay, out of that budget that's coming in, what can I put in my pocket? You know what I'm saying? They don't really look and get down to the nitty-gritty of what arts is doing for Philadelphia as far as students, as far as, you know, helping the extra, they're really helping the kids. They don't, I don't see or don't feel that they care. It's enough to get the videos, and when the cameras are rolling, it's enough to shake the hands, wear the suits, look good for the cameras and all that shit. But at the end of the day, the schools are still lack of funding. They're going to knock off some arts programs. You got so many talented kids here that don't know what avenue and what direction to go. It's a fucking shame that, you know, there's not shit set up here. I can't do it because I don't have the fucking money either to be able to say, yo, I'm going to put, you know, I'm going to leak $20 million into blah, 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 blah to make this and that happen. When money's leaked like that into foundations or organizations and shit like that, there's a ladder of how the money's broken down. They don't take that whole fucking $20 million and break it down to each kid and show how each kid's going to get what. No, they break it down to what you need for supplies. Who's going to run the organization? Well, I'm running the organization. I'm going to give myself $2 million or that $20 million just because I'm running the organization. So it's a lot of political shit that go on behind closed doors that nobody ever sees or hear of. But you hear, all you hear on the news is $20 million was given to the X, Y, and Z. By the time I get back down to the kids, it's probably $40,000. And what are you going to do with $40,000 when you got 40,000 kids? That's $1 a piece that these niggas is going to get. And how much can we do with $1 a piece to make sure these kids is going to get their art heard, seen, or whatever, and funded the right way when it's a fucking dollar piece? When it started at 20 million and it came down to 40,000 for 40,000 kids. I mean, it's just math. The people at the top need to stop being greedy and really break the shit down and show how the money was allocated to make sure shit got done. And that's just society in general with the system that we live in. Hustle, nigga. Straight up, just like that. Hustling is all you got to do. I mean, I'm not saying go sit on the corner and sell no coke or nothing like that, but you got friends, you got family, you know, you got people, you got to really feel it and believe in yourself that this is what you want. Like, look, I ain't trying to get no fucking job. This is what I do. I sell cupcakes. You going to support me or not? You know what I'm saying? I sell tube socks. You know, I sell this. You know, you got to really want it. You know, I don't give a fuck what you sell. You can sell pendants on t-shirts. You go to that church and say, listen, niggas, I've been giving this church all this money every fucking Sunday, and so has my mom and my grandma. So y'all niggas need to help back and reciprocate some of that fucking money we don't put up in this church. So bring that shit back down here and buy some of these nut ass pendants. I'm just saying, excuse my language, but this is some real shit though. Y'all have the avenues of the people that's in your families, people that's in your friends, people that's in your church, people that's in your schools. These niggas got some type of cushion money in between to support you. And if you adamant and you serious about what the fuck you want, you need to let people know that this is what I want. Your money, so I can fund this shit, so I cannot be poor, so I can feed my family, feed myself, and feed my dreams. So I'm gonna need you to put $1, $5, $10, $20, whatever you're gonna do, because those little bit extra money is gonna add up and keep adding up to be able to fund that dream. And when you get that money, don't go buy no fucking Jordans. Reinvest into your product. So that way, now you're not selling pendants anymore. You're selling packages of something that they probably really do want. You want to make yourself attainable and an asset to somebody as far as what you're selling, not just some shit that they could have bought that you put a crazy ass price on. And don't do the same shit another nigga done did already. Find out what you can do that's going to be better than that. Don't say, oh, Jamal sell t-shirts. I'm going to sell t-shirts too. I'm going to go buy me some iron-ons, iron it on a shirt, and then sell for $65. No, they're not going to buy it. They're going to go to H&M and buy a shirt for $13. Not your high-ass, cheap-ass $65 t-shirt that you ironed on with a fucking easy bake oven. Like, y'all really gotta figure out what the fuck you want. You know what I'm saying? Get a brand, get some profitable shit that you could sell that makes sense, and then believe in this shit and then go sell it. That's the only way you're gonna win. Some niggas in here with me painting. I mean, my son did this piece right here. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I was like, son, what the fuck is that? He was like, dad, this is my Muhammad Ali piece. I was like, yo, that's all that, cuz. Like, look at it. Like, the colors are cool. The nigga's 7 years old, and he did this piece. And it's like, I mean, I love it. I actually went and got it printed. But me as his parent, what I need to do is show that I can invest into him and I can believe in him. You know what I'm saying? It may not be Van Gogh or no other shit like that, but I see niggas sell paintings like this for over thousands of dollars. You know what I'm saying? Now, if I tell people at the show, yo, my son did this piece, y'all need to support this little nigga because he got dreams of wanting to be a good artist like his dad. This piece starting at $500. Who want to get it? Somebody might buy it. Somebody might not buy it. Somebody will buy it. Or they might buy the print for $10. You know what I'm saying? Now, if I take that money that he got and put it into a smart account for him and start his own bank account and show him that, yo, son, you know, you made that piece. Somebody believed in you and they bought that piece. Now you have money in your account to fund your dreams. The whole point and purpose of what I did there wasn't to sell his piece and have him make money. It was to give him ambition. It was to give him drive and give him stamina to say, you know what? My dad believes in me. So I believe in myself. I created something that from nothing and got a product out of it. Somebody else believed in my dreams. These are the type of things that I want to instill in my children so that they can grow up. It's not the actual painting. It's not the, you know, it's more so the metaphor that comes out of that. And that's what a lot of parents fail to realize. They go to work every fucking day to still not afford to be able to pay for the kids to go to college and just live every day. And you still a fucking slave. No, I want to instill and teach my kids that you don't got to be a slave. And if you want to go to college, you can pay for that shit and not have to get no fucking loans. It's possible. But you got to believe in them and show them that the way that's set up for us is not the fucking way, because you're still going to be in debt, broke, and living from check to check. So, you know, I don't know. It's all about how you raise your own kids. I raise my kids differently than everybody else. But when I'm painting and doing my thing, I make good money doing what I'm doing. I want to show my kids they can too. I'm not telling them to go be artists and shit. Maybe that's not what the fuck they want to do. Maybe they want to bake cookies or bake cakes or I don't know. Maybe my son want to play sports. But at the end of the day, you know what I'm saying? Believe in the shit that they want to do. Because if you as their parents, the motherfuckers that made them don't believe in them, how the fuck they going to believe in themselves? They're going to look at their dad and their mom like, man, these motherfuckers is losers. I don't want to be like these niggas. I want my kids to look at me and be like, yo, my kid, they went to some museum and shit the other day. And they was talking about art and shit. My son was like, yo, man, my dad's an artist. This shit in here corny. With a K, you know what I mean? And it's like, yo, like, my son said that about me because he feel good about his dad. You know what I'm saying? He feel good that and he's proud of what I'm doing. And he knows that I make my own rules and stuff like that. So, you know, just because I paint, don't tell me saying y'all to paint. Y'all do whatever y'all got to do, but just believe in them. You know what I mean? Give them the avenues and give them the ways. Even if you can't give them money, give them your time. You know, my son came in here and did that while I was painting. But he had my time, he had my attention, and he has my praise on that piece. So when I go later on today and show him that I printed that up for him and I put in a nice little frame and everything, he's going to be like, damn, my dad really fucked with this painting. Be honest with you, man, fuck those museums, yo. Straight up, like, you can get inspiration by walking down the street. You can get inspiration by the shit that you can relate to, because most of us niggas can't relate to that museum shit because we don't know what the fuck they're talking about. You know what I'm saying? I don't know nobody that Van Gogh shit. I'm not saying don't educate yourself and learn about it. That's cool, but there's a lot of Van Gogh shit going on in your own neighborhoods that you can, like, look into and see what's going on. Like, there's a lot of white motherfuckers that don't know shit about what's going on in Puerto Rican homes and neighborhoods, what's going on when Lela makes... And Lela is abuela, and you say Lela is short for abuela. So there's a lot of people that don't know what that's about. They don't know what that rice pot, the big one, the metal big one that's in the back that Lela used all the time when she make her rice in, and she put a gondolas in there and just wrecked the shit up. They don't know what patilas is. They don't know about none of that stuff. So, like, there's people out there that if you made paintings and artwork on shit that you can relate to, they'd be like, damn, I didn't even know what that was. So they don't give a, like, all that shit that they talk about in museums is cool and all, but they telling you that that's cool. No, you don't have to believe that. You can be, it can be cool. Whatever you believe in and whatever you're living in your life, you can make it cool. So the inspiration is in your, in right in front of your face. It's right in your lifestyle. If you see a crackhead strung out or somebody that's hunched over like this in a neighborhood, me and you might know what this means. That means that motherfucker is coked the fuck out. He's a ghetto. A ghetto is a person that's strung out on drugs. This is stuff that we see. This is stuff that we actually see with our own eyes and walk by in our own neighborhoods. That's the stuff that you need to say. That's inspiration to say either I don't want to be like that nigga, or I've seen this and witnessed this and know what happens in my hometown or know what happened in my lifestyle. So inspiration got to come from what you really believe and what you see, not the shit that you just read in books and quote-unquote white people or the people that's behind a desk or with the bow ties on and all that shit is telling you this is culture. No, culture is the shit that's in your culture that you see, that you can relate to, that's real shit. So you get your inspiration from whatever fuck you live in your life, straight up. I love Philly because I talk this way because I'm from Philly. I live this way because I'm from Philly, and I've seen some shit. I've survived robberies. I've survived my best friend blowing his fucking brains out because he was stressed out. I survived child support. You know what I'm saying? I love Philly because this shit made me who I am. You know what I'm saying? I can go to any state, any city, and live a free man and be happy with who I am artistically as a man, as a father, as a husband, as a friend, and as a businessman. You know what I'm saying? So Philly made me who I am. And without all the fucked up shit and growing up bad or things wasn't good or all the happy stuff or summertime or whatever, hip-hop music, whatever it was, it's all because of my hometown, Philadelphia. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's been some amazing things that happened here. I mean, when the Phillies won the World Series, we was jumping down the street, hanging off fucking light poles and shit. That's Philly, man. You know what I'm saying? The best cheesesteaks in Philly isn't fucking Pat's. It's fucking Ishka Bibbles on South Street. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you really from Philly, you really know what's going on. You know what the fuck a water ice is. Everybody don't know what a water ice is. Water ice is a banging ass icy fucking dessert made with water, ice, of course, but it's sweet as shit, and you gotta probably go to Rita's. It's the best place to get it, and there's fruit in it. This is what makes you a Philly native, not the fucking Rocky Steps. Fuck Rocky, you know, not the fucking pretzel. I don't even eat pretzels. Like, you want to really come to Philly, come to Philly, come in the city, come see what's going on, and live this shit. Like, I'm happy to say I'm a Philly native. I'll probably get that shit tatted on me one of these days. But Philly is where the fuck I'm from. We've made the best stars, the best artists come out of here, the best network. Anything that's in Hollywood had to stop by Philadelphia. That's straight the fuck up. So I'm happy to say I'm from this bitch. I mean, social media, I'm on Instagram as Ivben Taqiy. I got another page, if you don't give a fuck about my kids, Ivben Taqiy Art. I got Ivben 1908, which is my clothing line. I'm on Facebook under Taqiy Muhammad, but that's my real name. You want to find me under there, that's cool too. But, you know, just look out for me. You can hashtag me, you can Google me. You'll see whatever pops up, but I'm going to keep doing this art shit. I'm going to take it to the next level. I'm going to be doing paints for Diddy, all these other rich motherfuckers. Look, I just want their money. You know, I do good shit. I do dope-ass artwork. And if y'all niggas want to fuck with me, please fuck with me. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to keep coming up with creative shit, you know, because y'all niggas need niggas like me. Because y'all niggas don't exist unless creative poor motherfuckers like me is creating this shit. So, at the end of the day, y'all going to be watching this video. Y'all going to be watching this YouTube, whatever fuck y'all going to be watching, to say, please get that nigga on payroll. So I can make my money, but unlike y'all niggas, I'm bringing that shit back to the hood because these other poor motherfuckers, they need a handout. They need somebody to help lift them up and other programs and shit to really make some shit. That $2 million will be seen scattered throughout the neighborhood so that we don't have fucked up prodigies or fucked up people on drugs and shit. That's they had to go that route, you know. Shout out to my man Atif. He's not here with me no more. But, you know, stress is a motherfucker. Find out what you want to do in life. Live it. Dream it, build it, and make that motherfucker work for you. This is Ivben Taqiy. I'm here at waterice.com. You're scooped to everything Philly. Check them out.